every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do.
Welcome back to the Find Your Purpose Now podcast. Tate, today we're going to talk about how you know, how you can measure five different ways that you're really in the sweet middle of your purpose. It's the measurement of all five points of true prosperity that come along with, that accompany you living your purpose. So the five points, and then we'll break them down, are healthy relationships, peace, joy, a sense of wellness, and the financial provision to do what you were born to do. Okay, so let's break those down. So the first one, I'm not sure that they're necessarily in this order, but I would think that a lot of the issues that we have in our lives have to do with our relationships. So healthy relationships. Oh boy, we could probably talk for a week about having healthy relationships, creating them, nurturing them, trying to turn toxic relationships into good, healthy relationships. There's just a whole lot there. But from the standpoint of really asking yourself, am I in my purpose? Am I living it? Because, hey, everything's not perfect. In fact, there are a lot of issues that I deal with. So is this really my purpose? Well, first of all, let me tell you, nothing's ever going to be perfect here. That's the nature of this life. Perfection is just, if we're just real, perfection is not going to be achieved. So I think a lot of people have in their minds that the goal of this life is to reach this nirvana of this perfect situation where you have, like in a Hollywood movie where everything just winds up just being perfect and you're married to the perfect person, you have the perfect kids, you have the great house, you have perfect cars and take amazing vacations and all that stuff. You know, all of that is a fantasy. It's not to say that you can't experience sometimes like that. Yeah, absolutely. But God never promised us a perfect life. In fact, just really the opposite. Jesus said that we would have trouble in this life. He said that we have an enemy, an ancient enemy who came, whose purpose is to kill, steal, and destroy. So let's just get rid of the notion right now that we're trying to have a perfect life, because we're just not. You have to manage your expectations, okay? It's fabulous to have goals, absolutely have goals, but don't make them so unrealistic that when you find yourself in a situation where you have real troubles, that you use that as a measuring stick and say, well, I must not be living right. I must not be in my purpose. I must not be a good person or whatever, because I don't have this beautiful, perfect life. Okay, let's be done with that. Most relationships, should I say most, many, all relationships are messy. They can get very difficult, because we're human beings and everybody's not perfect and everybody has a different perspective, a lens, if you will, through which they see the world. And we may think others are wrong. They may think we're wrong, and we may be about some things. I mean, does anybody really have it dialed in perfectly to where they know everything and are 100% correct about everything? No, they don't. There's nobody like that. Well, Jesus, I guess. But as far as the people in our lives, no. We're all flawed. So I guess maybe this all comes down to managing expectations. We can't expect other people to see things the way we see them because they have a different perspective and they have a different context and they have different thoughts, and people connect the dots between this and that differently. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. So I have a friend for, gosh, more than 30 years. I just love her. I'm a conservative Christian, and she is a liberal Christian. And she's been a foster parent to, I don't even know if she knows how many kids. It's so many kids over decades of her life. So my friend is pro-choice, and I'm pro-life. And I asked her one time to please help me understand. I told her, I started with, I don't want to argue. I love you. But I don't understand how you can care so deeply about children, so much so that you've taken children, countless children, into your home and included them in your family and love them into wholeness. How can you do that and be in favor of abortion? And in my mind, abortion is a euphemism for killing babies. I don't understand. So my friend said, I'm so glad you asked, with a smile. She didn't get offended, and she didn't yell or snap at me and bite my head off about politics or ideology or anything. She just simply smiled and said, I'm so glad that you asked. I said, I don't understand how you can be a Christian, and I know that you are, and how you can be pro-choice. I don't get it. And she said, okay, so let me just help you understand. She said, God gave us each our free will, right? We can do whatever we want. We have free will. We can follow him. We cannot. We can believe. We can just totally be an atheist. We can be good, or we can commit crimes or whatever. Right. Yes, that's right. He gave us our free will. She said, so if somebody feels like they can't raise a child, but they don't want a child, they think they won't be a good mother, they're afraid that the generational mental illness that everybody in their family has had is going to be passed to another child, and they don't want to do that to that child. Or they just simply can't afford to feed another child. Or whatever. Whatever reason that person has for thinking they can't, they just can't do it. God gives them their free will to do whatever they want to do. So my friend said, I will too. I'll let them do whatever they choose to do, just like God does. I had to sit there and think about it for a second, because I understand that what my friend was saying to me was well thought out. She was sincere in her belief. She did not take my question lightly. And it was logical. Her response was logical to me. After I had a chance to really think about it and process it, I thought, okay, it does help me understand where you're coming from. I still don't agree, because that same logic, if you extrapolate it out to the six-month-old baby who still isn't sleeping through the night, and so mom is sleep deprived and, you know, like losing her mind, under that logic, it would be okay to kill the six-month-old baby or the two-year-old toddler who's getting into everything and the mom just is frustrated and crazy and, you know, well, no, I'm not going to be okay with killing the toddler, killing this baby who doesn't sleep through the night. I'm just never going to be okay with any of that. And, but it doesn't change the fact that people do those things. I mean, we know that in the United States, gosh, for many, many years, there's an average of 4 children a day who die, child abuse, making abortion more available hasn't changed the fact that a lot of people kill their children. But back to the point of when we talk about healthy relationships, see, you probably thought I forgot and I went off on a rabbit trail. No, this is my point. It's important for us to have healthy relationships. And the way to do that is to try to understand other people and to help them understand us. So going back to my example with my friend, so we're sitting there and we're talking and I'm trying to process what she just said. And I'm saying, okay, I think I understand what you're saying. I still don't agree, but I love you. And I didn't try to persuade her to believe what I believe. I didn't try to get her to change her mind. But in that conversation, in that moment, I understood her better. And I understood a lot of other people who feel like she feels. There are Christians who say, well, when you abort a baby, the baby goes right back to heaven with God. Isn't that better than a horrible life that they might have with people who don't want them? Well, okay, there's another logical response. But I have to say, my mother could have aborted me. She didn't want me. She left. But gosh, she gave birth first. And I have an amazing life. And I think I've been able to do good things in this life. So I don't buy the argument that it's better to kill the baby than give the baby a shot at life, even though there are going to be some, or there may be, some hard things that the child will have to go through. Because I went through some hard things. A lot of us go through hard things. But we still have a purpose. But the point is, in that whole conversation with my friend, it didn't destroy our relationship. It enhanced our relationship. It made me feel closer to her because I understood better. She understood where I was coming from and where I continued to stand on the subject. Gosh, can you imagine a world in which we didn't expect others to read our minds and see our point of view and just assume they should get it and assume they should feel like us and think like us and believe like us and vote like us and whatever else, you know, I could tie onto that sentence. Everybody has their own brain, their own eyes, their own experience train, where they take a situation or a subject or whatever, and they put it into the context of what they understand and what they know and what they believe and their values and all of that stuff. And they arrive at their opinion. If you don't agree, instead of arguing, instead of trying to persuade, try valuing the relationship above all else and asking questions. You might find that there's a story or some contextual thing that helps you understand that person better. And let's stop holding people accountable for things they don't understand. And they won't understand until you take the time to invest in the relationship, to explain how you feel, what you know for sure. Okay. I could go on and on about that, but let's set that aside. So healthy relationships, it doesn't mean that you're rowing in the same direction with another person and there's never any conflict and you agree on everything and everything's just rosy all the time. That's not realistic. Because people are going to have bad days and they're going to be grouchy or they're not feeling well and they're irritable or whatever. So being the best we know how to be, giving people grace and mercy and trying to understand them and where they're coming from will go a long way toward creating healthy relationships, turning sort of toxic relationships around, all of that. Give it a try. So that's number one. Number two, peace. The measurement of how closely aligned you are in your life with your purpose. Gosh, peace is probably the number one thing. And let's not confuse what real peace is. It's not a ceasefire in a difficult situation. It's not just the absence of conflict, but peace is inside of you. Real peace, true peace. You can be in the midst of a huge storm in your life, and you can bring peace to it. Because you carry the peace inside of you. I think that to the degree that we're living in our purpose, that's the level of peace that we're going to feel. So if you feel discontent, if you feel a sense of chaos inside of you, like things just aren't right, pay attention to that. Because that's a really good indicator that you're really not in the sweet middle of your purpose. Number three is joy. Now, let's not confuse joy with happiness, because happiness is a feeling and it's fleeting. You can be happy one minute, you get passed over for a promotion, and you're not happy anymore. You're disappointed and you're discouraged. And yeah, joy, like peace, is inside of you. It's not just a feeling. It's part of you. When joy is in you, you don't have it. It has you. And you see things through a more optimistic lens when you're joyful, when you're a joyful person. Your whole life becomes more of a joyful journey. You're better able to take things in stride. You're better able to pick yourself up when you get knocked down. Living without joy is awful. I've done it. I know how it feels. I don't ever want to go back. So measure the degree of your purpose by the degree of your joy. Number four is a sense of wellness, a sense that all is well with your soul. It's a feeling of like, it's hard to put it into words for me, but sort of the feeling that nothing is missing from my life and nothing is broken. Now, that's not to be confused with everything's perfect and, you know, because no, in this life, everything's not going to be perfect. That happens after this life, if you're going the right direction. But that sense of wellness, it's calm. It's a calm that, again, like peace and joy that you carry with you into every relationship, into every conversation, into your work, into your interactions with neighbors and friends and family and everybody in your life. And then the fifth one is financial provision. It's enough money to do what you were made to do, to live out your purpose. You know, some people need very little money to live out their purpose. You know, for somebody whose purpose is some giant endeavor that's going to cost $100 million to do, well, then, you know what? You will have or have access to $100 million to fulfill your purpose. God will provide what you need when you need it. Probably not a day too soon, but what you need will be there for you when you need it. If you have faith, if you believe, if you are obedient to the leading of God's Holy Spirit in your life and you do your part, we each have a part. I've noticed that God doesn't just make a deposit into my bank account while I'm, you know, laying on the sofa eating potato chips. We have to move. We have to do something. I like the old African proverb that says, when you pray, move your feet. So when we know, when we are clear on our part and what we're supposed to do, and we do that, the financial provision for what we need will result. So those are the five things that you can measure your level of purpose fulfillment in your life with. Because when you're there, when you're in the sweet middle of what you're supposed to be doing, you will have a balance of all those things. And when something is out of balance, that's a real indicator that something has to change. Something's not quite right. And the way that you sort of straighten your path back out is through prayer. Ask God. Pray. Okay, what am I supposed to be doing? Am I supposed to be looking for a new job? Is there a different job I'm supposed to be at? Am I supposed to move? Am I supposed to open my own business? Whatever it is, be open, be willing, ask sincerely, and then listen. Just pay attention to the opportunities that come your way, to the needs that you hear about. Because the purpose for each of us involves meeting needs of others in the way that we are equipped to be able to do. So that's it for today. I hope you'll check back with me next week. We're going to be looking at what the Bible says about finding and living our purpose, and how we can sort of supercharge it. I hate to say shortcuts because I don't feel like there's any, you know, any real shortcut other than plugging into the power of God, connecting to God. It's like taking an appliance that's not plugged in. Okay, well, it's a toaster or whatever, and it's sitting there. It's a toaster. Whether it's plugged in or not, it's a toaster. But when you plug it in to the juice, to the, you know, the electrical outlet, all of a sudden, this appliance can do what it was made to do. So in the future, we're going to talk about how when you connect with God, you take your natural, plug into God's super, and you really can achieve supernatural results. Things that you could never do on your own, you can do with God. All right, see you next time.
The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do. Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.